Hi, everyone. It's Tim. Welcome to another story about a national park that has played an important role in the history of science. I'm joined by another talented filmmaking student from American University's Center for Environmental Filmmaking, Marissa Woods.
Thanks for joining us. Today, we're going to learn about Thule Springs Fossil Beds National Monument, which is right on the edge of Las Vegas. It was only recently established as a National Park Service unit, but it's been attracting attention from the scientific community for over a century.
That park was a testing ground for one of the most important scientific methods to be developed in the 20th century, one that resulted in a Nobel Prize and that's been used every day in many fields of science. We'll begin by learning about the park.
Today, Thule Springs is a desert, but that wasn't always the case. At several times in the past, this place had a lot of water. That water and associated plant life supported a diverse community of animals whose bones have since been preserved as fossils. And there are a lot of fossils. We caught up with paleontologist Lauren Perry for an introduction to the park.
So the sediments that are found at Thule Springs are from the Pleistocene, which commonly is known as the Last Ice Age. One of the largest animals that used to live at Thule Springs was the Columbian mammoth. We also had extinct camels. We had bison, sometimes even a long-horned bison. There were also some really interesting predators, including the smilodon or saber-toothed cat, as well as the dire wolf.
All of those fossils and a handful of human artifacts have attracted scientists to the area for over 100 years. One of the most important research projects was the Thule Springs expedition in the early 1960s. We talked with Vince Santucci to get some background on the expedition. He's the senior paleontologist for the National Park Service.
The Thule Springs expedition was an effort to determine if Ice Age mammals and humans coexisted. And so between October of 1962 and February of 1963, a multidisciplinary team was put together consisting of geologists and archaeologists and paleontologists. They used the largest bulldozer known at the time in the world to create these trenches that were hundreds of meters long, 35 to 40 feet deep, so that they could expose these Ice Age layers of rock. The Thule Springs expedition was later nicknamed the Big Dig, based on the fact that this was a huge undertaking.
What motivated the Big Dig? To answer that, we need to look at two earlier periods in history. The first was the early 1930s. At that time, there was a lot of interest in when humans first arrived and spread throughout North America. Vince, archaeologists came to Thule Springs in the early 1930s. What did they find among those fossil bones?
Charcoal, which is very important, and an infamous obsidian flake. At the time, they felt that the occurrence of charcoal at Thule Springs provided evidence of stone hearths and fire pits that were used by the Paleo-Indians. What's interesting about the obsidian flake is that it was found in association with some extinct camel bones. So little by little, they were finding pieces that suggested that humans coexisted with Ice Age animals, but they didn't have the smoking gun.
The elusive smoking gun would be the absolute ages of fossil bones and human artifacts. But in the 1930s, nobody had a way of determining those ages. It was in the 1950s, after the development of the atomic bomb, that a powerful new tool was invented, radiocarbon dating. And that new tool provided the second motivation for the Thule Springs expedition.
We asked Kathleen Springer about radiocarbon dating and its role in this story. She's a research geologist who studies the ancient ecosystems of Thule Springs and their response to climate change.
So carbon is one of many elements that has radioactive isotopes. This was discovered, you know, essentially during the Manhattan Project in World War II, where they were trying to figure out all the kinds of things that had radioactive isotopes, essentially what could blow up. The radioactive form of carbon 14 is taken up by all living things on Earth. And it was discovered that when an animal or plant dies, that uptake of carbon 14 ceases. and that you can measure the decay of that in this plant or animal. Willard Libby was this professor at the University of Chicago that made that connection that you could utilize this decay to date things you find anywhere in the dirt, to date human artifacts, to date wood, to date historical objects. He won a Nobel Prize for this really creative endeavor, which he should have. And he was keenly interested in the peopling of North America. That was actually a hobby of his.
Back to the big dig. A geologist named Vance Haynes was the project director. He invited Willard Libby to participate, and Libby jumped at the chance. Between the geologist's detailed mapping of rock layers and charcoal deposits and fossils and human artifacts, and Libby's measurements of radiocarbon dates, they constructed a detailed sequence and timeline for Thule Springs.
The Thule Springs expedition was unique in that it was actually the first place in North America where radiocarbon dating was performed in a field setting in this kind of scale.
So Kathleen, what did the researchers learn from the radiocarbon dates they got back?
The layers that had the human cultural artifacts were younger than the horizons that had the Pleistocene megafauna, and there was no direct evidence that those animals and those people were hanging out together or the people were hunting them. It was a huge letdown for the archaeological community to be as blunt as possible. They had already done the artwork for the cover of National Geographic. It had already been done.
If you have an opportunity to work in an archaeological site or a fossil site, when you're talking to the public, one of the questions that comes up probably more than anything else is how old are these archaeological remains or how old are these paleontological remains? Today, carbon-14 analysis remains the gold standard for age dating in archaeology, paleontology, geology, and other disciplines.
Every single study that's done all adds up to this really, really rich story that just keeps getting better and more complete over time.
It's just a natural laboratory for any number of future studies. It just has everything, you know, with the climate story and the animals and the geology all tied up in a beautiful little Thule Springs bow, you know.
Well, Thule Springs may be a new park, but it's contributed so much to the history of science.
You know, before we looked into this story, I did not know that there are parks associated with Nobel Prizes. But I guess I shouldn't be surprised given how much science happens in our parks.
Well, thanks for joining us. And keep an eye out for more episodes of National Parks and the History of Science.